Hi, friend, this is Charley Pride, and I hope you'll be listening when I'm aboard the Ralph Emery Show.
Make someone a gold medal memory today.
Hello, everybody. Welcome again to the Ralph Emery Show, brought your way by Gold Medal Flower with our special in-person guest, superstar Charley Pride. Charley, welcome aboard.
Well, thank you, Ralph.
Nice to have you with us, and I'm looking forward to hearing you sing this week.
Well, I want to thank you for having me on this show of yours, and I've been looking forward to doing it a long time, and I'm glad to be here.
You're really in good voice?
I hope so.
All right, why don't we start with San Antone?
Okay.
Rain dripping off the brim of my hat, sure is cold today. Here I am walking down 66, wish she hadn't done me that way. Sleeping under a table in a roadside park, a man could wake up dead. But it sure seems warmer than it did, sleeping in our king-sized bed. Is anybody going to San Antone or Phoenix, Arizona? Any place is all right as long as I can forget I've ever known her. Whipping down the neck of my shirt like I ain't got nothing on. But I'd rather fight the wind and rain than what I've been fighting at home. Yonder comes a truck with the U.S. mail, people writing letters back home. Tomorrow she'll probably want me back, but I'll still be just as gone. Is anybody going to San Antone or Phoenix, Arizona? Any place is all right as long as I can forget I've ever known her.
That's our show opener by our guest, Charley Pride. Is anybody going to San Antone? Now, here's a new easy way to perk up any breakfast.
Just bake them in the oven and you got them made. The cold, no fried donuts and they turn out great. Cinnamon, sugared applesauce or chocolate, made the new gold medal way. When the season changes and the leaves start turning brown, that's when your family wants donuts, but you just don't have the time. But now your troubles are over, Gold Medal's found a new way to make your family donuts, the brand new no fry way. Just bake them in the oven and you got them made. They're called no fry donuts and they turn out great. Cinnamon, sugared applesauce, or chocolate, made the new gold medal way. Made the new gold medal way.
One taste of these new no-fry donuts and breakfast will never be the same without them. Our special guest this week is Charley Pride, and Charley, you've got to tell me about John Wayne. I understand you met him a while back.
Yeah, we played out at the Hilton International for our first time out there, Ralph, and I was told that he was coming in, and I went out to meet him at the airport. He was about an hour and a half late, but he came, and he's just about like off-screen as he is on-screen. He's just himself, you know, and you asked me earlier, was he as stern or...
Is he as tough-looking as in person as he is on the screen?
As he was on screen, yes. But he's a nice guy, though. I mean, you know, as far as the roles, you know, when he's hitting a guy upside the head or something. But, I mean, he's a nice guy. And I was very, very thrilled to have him at my show. You know, a guy of that stature, man, that's something that kind of makes you feel pretty good.
Was he sitting on the front row?
No, he had a booth right behind the the front row seats.
Charley, there's a rumor that you're going to be in a John Wayne movie, and that was the reason he came to see you.
Well, not really. It's a possibility, let's face it. I mean, I want to get into the movies, and he said himself that if a part comes up that fits, sure, he'd be glad to have me in a movie, but it wasn't nothing really discussed about it.
Are you and John Wayne old friends by any chance?
No, just just from that, him wanting to come to my show. He's a fan as far as I can gather.
That was my next question. Is he a fan of your music?
Well, I didn't just come out and ask him, but I assume if he wanted to fly all the way in his private jet to catch it and not coming in to strictly discuss anything about a movie, so I figured that he must have been familiar with my music.
Charley, you've conquered about all the fields you've been in, from cotton to music, and in show business, you've become such a giant. I wondered if there's anything in show business you'd like to accomplish that you haven't yet. Would you like to be in the movie?
Yes, I would. I would like to, speaking of John Wayne, give him a run for his money, and Paul Newman, Sidney Poitier, all of them. I would like to. I think I could do it.
Have they all approached you?
No, I've had offers from different TV programs. Like I turned down one for Mod Squad. I'm chiefly looking for something. It's sort of like a song, a script that I can read that will hit me like a song. With that, this is for me. I mean, something that would be natural for me. I don't want to play something just to play. This part, I think, was portraying a ex-fighter that was on drugs or something like that, and I didn't want to play anything like that. I'd like to play something sort of that fits, you know, like looking for a song or something like that, and I feel it'll be there once.
Yeah,
I see
a part with some meat in it.
Well, with the right kind of script.
Charley, I think we'll move along to a song, and then we'll get back to this, all right?
Okay.
Here's David Houston and Barbara Mandrell.
Cross my morning cup of coffee and see an angel smiling back at me. And I think of how your loving seems to fit just like a glove, and your disposition suits me to a T.
And nothing gives me greater satisfaction than knowing that you feel the way you do, 'cause it makes my life worth living, and I get a thrill from giving all my love, you and only you.
You and me together, we're a perfect match. In each other, we have found the perfect catch. Like two lovebirds on the eggs of happiness, knowing they're gonna hatch. You and me together, we're a perfect match. Just what I need and when I need it. With you, contentment wasn't hard to find. And though we have our problems, we'll let love and kindness solve. You'd think that we could read each other's minds.
And sometimes I think if we should start all over, I'll bet we wouldn't want to change a thing. Through the good times and the bad ones, just a few real sad ones, we found happiness that only true love brings.
You and me together, we're a perfect match. In each other, we have found the perfect catch. Like two lovebirds on the eggs of happiness, knowing they're gonna hatch. You and me together, we're a perfect match.
That's David Houston and Barbara Mandrell, and the song is called A Perfect Match. Charley, I ran into you about a year and a half ago at George and Tammy's Park, and I know you're a big fan of theirs. You want to bring on this next fella here?
Well, I just don't mind at all. A Picture of Me by George Jones.
Yeah, I got the impression the day that you were at the park that you're a big fan of his.
I am. In fact, I just left him a while ago.
There's an old boy on stage who had no idea Charley was around. I remember the Jones boys.
Yes, one of
you remember that?
It was Charlie, not Charlie Justice, James Hawley.
Anyway, he goes and he tells the crowd, here's an old Charley Pride hit, and he goes into it.
So
I think it was San Antonio, wasn't it?
No, so afraid of losing you again.
And about halfway through, you eased up right behind him and started singing with him, but blew his mind, didn't it?
Well, he didn't know. they said, go out there. I said, no, go ahead. And they shoved me out, and the people saw me, and then...
Wow.
I just...
I can't say the roof fell in. There was no roof there that day. Let's listen to George Jones.
Imagine a world where no music was playing. Then think of a church with nobody praying. If you've ever looked up at a sky with no blue, then you've seen a picture of me without you. Have you walked in a garden where nothing was growing? I stood by a river when nothing was flowing. If you seen a red rose unkissed by the dew, then you've seen a picture of me without. Sunday morning with no church bells ringing. If you've watched as the part of a child breaks in two, then you've seen a picture of me without.
That's an awful good record, but George Jones, George with a picture of me. Remember how much time and effort your mother spent baking? Used to take hours, but today gold medal flour makes baking easy enough for a beginner. How? Well, in the Betty Crocker kitchens, talented home economists are constantly developing new recipes and updating old favorites to make baking easier, quicker than ever before. Blender cakes, one-rise mixer breads, pat-in-the-pan pie crust. Revolutionary recipes like these are given to you free in gold medal sacks. And even though they're as modern as tomorrow, they taste just as good as the old-fashioned baking you remember. What's more, when you bake a Betty Crocker recipe with gold medal flour, it'll come out right even if you make little measuring mistakes. That's why they say gold medal gives you a margin for error. So why don't you bake a gold medal memory today's way with a Betty Crocker recipe? Charley, if you'll bring out the next little lady, we'll move right along here.
Well, this is Miss Lynn Anderson. She has a real fine song out called Fool Me.
Ain't it kind of funny? They say a fool never learns. Play with fire and it always burns. Don't it kind of get you down? You treat me worse than before, but I keep coming back for more. 'Cause you're a deceiver and I'm a believer. It's just a game, I know, but I can't seem to let go. So fool me, fool me one more time. You can fake just for all time's sake. Look in my eyes, tell me those are lies, and just fool me, fool me one more time. Don't it make you wonder Why I keep playing make-believe? Do you really think I'm that naive? Don't it make you sad? I'm acting like I've got it made, even though it's just a masquerade. 'Cause you're a deceiver and I'm a believer. It's just a game I know, but I can't seem to let go. So fool me one more time. You can fake just for old time's sake. Look in my eyes, tell me those lies, and just fool me one more time. Fool me one more time. You can fake just for old time's sake. Look in my eyes, tell me those lies, and just fool me one more time. Come on, fool me one more time. Fool me one more time. Honey, fool.
That's the blonde-headed darling of country music, Lynn Anderson. And the song written by Joe South, who wrote Rose Garden. And the song is called Fool Me. Charley, I know you've been a country music fan a long time, before you became active as a singer, I guess. You remember Hawksaw's record of Lonesome 77203?
Yes, and Justin Tubb wrote the song.
And were you an amateur singer in those days? That was 1953.
Well,
63.
Yes, I was just singing in the cotton fields at home. I hadn't really thought about a career in singing, really, because I was wanting to play baseball then.
Right, well, I'm going to get to that. Right now, Tony Booth's going to revive this old Hawkshaw Hawkins ballad. Actually, not a ballad, an up-tempo tune.
Just call Lonesome 77203. Had our number changed today, although I hate it too. But each time the phone would ring, they'd want to speak to you. How it hurts to tell them you're not here with me. Maybe now a telephone will let me be. It's not in the book now, so you better write it down, just in case your love for me should ever come around. You might want to call and break the news to me. Just call Lonesome 77203. Telephone beside me all the time, hoping you might want to call and say you changed your mind. If you do, then darling, you know where I'll be. I'm at Lonesome 77203. You're the only one I'm giving my new number to. So now if the telephone should ring, I'll know it's you. If you ever long for love that used to be, just call Lonesome 77203. I'm at Lonesome 77203.
Tony Booth, young Tony singing Lonesome 77203. And now, for Gold Medal Flower, here's Paul Ott.
I remember when I was little playing cowboys with my brother Billy. Once we rode our make-believe horses right through the kitchen, and we scared mother so bad she dropped the flour she was sifting. She chased us and said if the cookies didn't come out just right, it was all our fault. But I could see she was laughing while trying to look so stern. And when the cookies were done, she gave us some hot right out of the oven, with cold milk from the spring house. Mother said gold medal flour in a Betty Crocker recipe gave her a margin for error when she baked. You know, in my mind, I can still see Mother and Billy and me eating those cookies as we sat at the old pine table in the kitchen back home. Bake someone a gold medal memory today.
Charley, I inserted a record here by a friend of yours, and if anybody introduces him on this show, you've got to introduce him.
Well,
Farron Young.
Yes, he's my Louisiana buddy, and I was talking to him today about both of us being Pisces, you know. He said, why you get all hung up on this astrology? I said, I'm not hung up on it. I said, I just believe in astrology, you know. And so I just left him a while ago, and I'd like to say that this has been a good record for him, this little girl of mine.
In a while, she'll come to wake me, just like always. She'll lean down and sweetly press her lips on mine and say, good morning, Daddy, good morning. How I love this little girl of mine. And we'll both sit at the table having coffee, and she'll say, Mama, put a lot of milk in mine, just like Daddy's, Mama, like my Daddy. How I love this little girl of mine. Then one day she'll grow up and be gone, and she'll have a small one of her own. Oh, but right now she's still Daddy's baby, just like always. And I'm so glad it's gonna be a long, long time. I'll hear good morning, Daddy, wake up, it's morning. Lord, how I love this little girl of mine. How I love this little girl of mine.
That's the sound of our friend Farron Young, the young sheriff, singing This Little Girl of Mine. My friends, you're listening to the Ralph Emery Show. Our guest is superstar Charley Pride. You like that word, that term?
Well, I've been hearing it so much. I appreciate the category and everything. I just don't consider myself a superstar. Maybe I don't want to accept what the accolades and admiration I've been getting. I appreciate them, but it just sort of, I like to say this, that I appreciate it, but I'm going to try to say to myself that it's fine, but I'm going to just pretend it's not there and keep my feet on the ground, you might say.
Charley, do you realize you're as big as Johnny Cash? Or bigger, maybe?
Well, I've been told.
Does that frighten you?
No, that's reading that. The reason it doesn't, I don't think about it in those terms too much. I just try to sing, and Go in the studio and record a record the best I can, then go on stage and do as good a show as I can, and then let whatever take care of itself. And it's been working out pretty good for me.
Yeah, I would say it's been working out all right. Let me bring out a cute record, a new record by Porter Wagoner. Porter with Katie Did.
Two sisters lived alone out in the country. Their names were Katie and her sister Liz. They farmed to raise the food that graced their table. Liz never went to town, but Katie did. Katie went to town each Saturday morning to sell the eggs and buy for her and Liz. Their only needs just some salt and sugar. They grew the rest, her and sister Liz. Liz never went to town like Katie did. Liz never knew a man but Katie did. For I saw them one evening when they thought they were hid. And you should have seen the things that him and Katie did. I walked by Liz and Katie's house each evening, through the woods on my way home from school. Then one evening Katie smiled and spoke so softly, as I stood there blushing like a fool. Then she asked me if I'd like to have some cookies that she'd baked for her and sister Liz. Then as Katie took me in their kitchen, I never closed the door, but Katie did. She took my hand and my heart beat so wild. A sound like coffee a-perking with no lid. And I shook so bad I even dropped my cookies. I didn't know of love, but Katie did. Liz never knew a man, but Katie did. She said it's lonely here with sister Liz. Just a dumb kid. I wish I'd known of love back then like Katie did. Oh, I wish I'd known of love back then like Katie did.
That's my buddy who has a... Do you know he has a street name for him in his hometown in Missouri? Oh. And Porter Wagoner Boulevard or something like that. That's Porter Wagoner with Katie Did. Charlie, I want to get back, if I may, and our guest is Charlie Pride, in case you've just joined us. I want to get back for a moment to the astrology that you mentioned a moment ago. I'm Pisces. When is your birthday?
March 18th.
Well, I'm 10 days ahead of you.
Yeah.
And I don't know how many years, but I'm March 10th. But I wondered if, you know, Pisceans are supposed to be very sensitive.
Yes.
Get their feelings hurt easily.
Yes.
Would you say this describes you?
Well, the reason I said about believing in astrology, way before I was given this book, people used to say I was so odd and unique and so forth, and I started reading and I found out that I'm just being myself. And of course, I noticed in the parts where if you're being sensitive, you can work on these things, and so I use it to help me counteract what I should be. If I don't want to be sensitive, then I'll tell myself don't be sensitive. And
is it that easy for you?
It has been. It takes quite a bit to get me upset or anything, and but when I do, it's kind of bad. And I feel bad once I get upset, so I try to stay not get upset about anything or get angry at anyone, and that kind of helps me.
Does it also help you to figure out the mood of an audience when you're working to them?
Well, this is, I think, sort of comes from experience of being in it, because when I first started out, I had to have to admit that I was a little bit nervous. But once I can get into my show, and I love to sing, and once it's like feeling a piece of silk or something, you can start to feel when you're starting to get a rapport with the audience, and it just starts to build. And I'm learning more and more how to feel each audience out, because sometimes, like if you have two shows and you have a matinee, usually the matinee is the hardest one to get them up to where you would like to have them, you know, at the point of the rapport you would like to have with them, more than the night show, because these are probably ones that didn't get the earlier tickets, and they, some are coming out of pure curiosity, or some have never seen it, and they sort of like waiting to see, and finally they get out of the curiosity of it and get into the real enjoyment of one another.
I always had a funny theory about matinees. I always thought maybe the shows didn't go over as well, or the audience was different because the sun is up. Did you ever work those where the sun's coming through the window?
Yes, that might be a part of it, but I think mostly it's just the time that they got the tickets, and they're the ones, they're not the real, they're fans, but they're not the ones that said, I'm going to get that first ticket the minute they hear that you're going to be in that particular town. And if they're putting on two shows and say the first one is sold out, and of course, I just did four shows in Wheeling, which is the second time we did it, and of course they all were sold out.
Yeah, I was going to say all your shows are sold out.
Yeah, but it's, of course, sometimes it varies. Maybe that my theory might not be right, and yours might be right. It might be a part of both, so it might be a point.
Yeah, you're sort of different in that when you become a superstar, it doesn't matter. They just want to get in any time you're going to be in there.
Well,
Charlie, let's play She's Good, Too Good to Be True.
Well, I'd like to.
Sometimes late at night, I wake up dreaming. I reach and feel for her. She's too good to be true. Then I touch the sleeping softness of my angel, and half asleep she turns to whisper, I love you. 'Cause she's just too good to be true, but she is. And in my arms she reassures me with a kiss. She's everything I ever looked for in a woman. She's just too good to be true, but she is. Like forever, till that evening sun will bring me home again. But then she's waiting at the door with her sweet loving, and tonight she'll be so good to me again. She's just too good to be true, but she is. And in my arms she reassures me with a kiss. She's everything I ever looked for in a woman. She's just too good to be true, but she is. She's just too good to be true, but she is.
Our guest star, Charley Pride, with Johnny Duncan's song, She's Too Good to Be True. It's times like this when I wish I had a trumpet. Introducing the first donuts that are easy to make. New no-fry donuts from Gold Medal Flour. They're different from any other kind because you don't fry them or even need them. Just bake them in the oven and you've got them made. Tender, luscious, and I can smell them already. You've got your choice of three flavors: cinnamon sugared, applesauce, or chocolate. When you make them, be sure and use Red Star yeast. It has absolutely no preservatives, so it's natural in every way. Red Star is dependable and easy to use, too. And now that it's autumn, bake up some easy no-fry donuts to go with that fresh-pressed apple cider. Where do you get the recipe? In Gold Medal sacks that say, No Fry Donuts. Now I think we'll bring on Miss Tammy Wynette. Tammy's hot record, My Man.
My man, understand, he holds me in the palm of his hand, and I like it. I like it. He's a dream, the real thing. He always makes me feel like a queen, and I love it. I love it. His arms are warm, they keep me away from harm, and I'm proud of it. So proud of it. He's mine, he's fine. He makes a funny feeling go up my spine, and I want to keep it like this all the time.
I guess Tammy's singing about old George there, Charlie.
All right.
Tammy Wynette singing My Man. And here's an RCA Victor stablemate of yours, Charlie. You know this young fella?
Yes, and in fact, he's wrote a couple of songs at least that I recorded at. She didn't...
She thinks I still care.
No, no. You Never Did Give Up On Me. He wrote the song along with Alan Reynolds, and... And I like this one too, Baby Bye Bye by Dickie Lee.
About you every day, never know what you're gonna do next or what you're gonna say. I don't think your love for me is true, or you couldn't do what you've been putting me through. Say why, no use to sit and just cry. This time, baby, it's baby bye-bye. You don't understand anything I've ever said, 'cause you act like our love life something you read. I can't seem to get inside to you. So there's just one thing left for me to do.
Dickie Lee, Dickie, who used to be a pugilist. Yeah, he was a
fighter,
Golden Glove fighter.
Yes. And that kind of threw me there for a minute, but...
Do you like that word?
That's...
You'll notice he's the country singer with the cauliflower ears.
You said that.
No, I'm just kidding. Dickie was pretty good. He won a scholarship to Memphis State University using the gloves.
Well, I tried that when I was in high school, and boy, they hit me in the nose with those things, and... those gloves, and I just couldn't stand it. I said, it's better sports than that, so I put them down.
Dickie Lee here on the Ralph Emery Show. Dickie with Baby Bye Bye. And now the gold medal singers with a call from Mama at the kitchen door.
Make someone a gold medal memory today.
Mama would call from the kitchen door. Come on, it's time to bake some more. I'd be there on the run, 'cause I knew we'd have lots of fun.
Baking up a gingerbread man, baking up a gingerbread man. Get the gold medal flour and the baking pan, baking a gingerbread man.
Now my daughter's 6 years old, and she doesn't have to be told. When it's gold medal bacon day, I can always hear her say,
we're baking up a gingerbread man, baking up a gingerbread man. Get the gold medal flour and the bacon pan, baking a gingerbread man, baking a gingerbread man. Bake someone a gold medal memory today.
You know, this is the first time I ever knew you were a pugilist, Charley. I'd heard about the baseball.
No, that was just a little thing in high school, Ralph. In fact, it was my brother. It was hitting me in the nose.
Where was this, in Sledge, Mississippi?
Sledge, Mississippi, yes.
Is your daddy, I heard a while back he retired. From the barbering.
No, he didn't. No, he's still, he's not driving the school bus anymore.
Well, I wasn't aware he did that. I thought he was just a barber.
No. He's been driving a school bus for about 2-3 years or maybe more. Maybe more than that. But all he does now is just go up on weekends and just cut hair on weekends, like on Saturdays, you know.
Charley, I guess you always got a free haircut then, growing up in the household of a barber.
Yes.
How many brothers and sisters do you have?
I have 7 brothers and 3 sisters living.
So you come from a big family.
Yes.
You and Dolly Parton.
Yeah.
Mercy.
Yeah.
What, I think you told me one time your daddy led you into country music.
Well, as far as listening to it when I was small, that's what we used to listen to. We picked cotton all week, and the solemn old judge, I remember... little bitty fella, and he come, and they ordered some pictures, and I talked to a lot of, what's his name? He used to wear the mustache.
David Cobb.
David Cobb.
He just retired.
Yeah, well, I used to think he looked like Clark Gable, you know, when he had the mustache, because they had pictures that you could send in and get, you know, in a little round circle. He was in a circle.
Now, you're talking about an early announcer at the Grand Ole Opry.
Yes.
And I guess you got pictures of the Opry stars, too.
Well, I'm not sure, but I think he still has the pictures. I've been planning on asking him for a long time, but I just remember watching. You know, I've got one in my office where it's a big blow-up, but it's not the same kind that Daddy got when he sent in to the Opry to get his.
What is your picture of?
Mine is, 1953, I believe.
Of the Grand Ole Opry?
Of the Grand Ole Opry. I believe it was 53. It might be further back than then.
Charlie, we're going to close this show with Kiss an Angel Good Morning, if that's all right.
That's all right with me.
Whenever I chance to meet some old friends on the street, they wonder how does a man get to be this way. I've always got a smiling face, anytime and any place. And every time they ask me why, I just smile and say, you've got to kiss an angel good morning and let her know you think about her when you're gone. Kiss an angel good morning and love her like the devil when you get back home. Well, people may try to guess the secret of a happiness, but some of them never learn it's a simple thing. The secret I'm speaking of is a woman and a man in love, and the answer is in this song that I always sing. You've got to kiss an angel good morning and let her know you think about her when you're gone. Kiss an angel good morning and love her like the devil when you get back home. Kiss an angel good morning and let her know you think about her when you're gone. Kiss an angel good morning and love her like the devil when you get back home.
That's our guest star, Charley Frank Pride.
Right.
Right? Charley with Kiss an Angel Good Morning. Friends, there's our theme, and it's time for us to leave you. Gold Medal Flower has brought you the Ralph Emery Show with our special guest, Charley Pride. And Charley, I look forward to sharing a microphone with you tomorrow.
Okay.